everyone, welcome, and pleased to have everybody here. And I wanted to also thank the sponsors of the event, which is the Bangor Public Library, the League of Women Voters, Departments of Sociology and Political Science at the University of Maine, and the Scholar Strategy Network. And I know some folks here, but I'm Amy Freed. I'm a political scientist at the University of Maine. I'm the chair of the department there. And I'm also happen to be a member of the League of Women Voters, which I'm happy to say. And I'm the co-leader of the Maine chapter of the Scholar Strategy Network. Both groups, I would say, are groups that really try to promote engaged, thoughtful citizenship. And in fact, the League of Women Voters grew out of the whole struggle for women's rights. It actually came out of the National American Woman Suffrage Association, and the Maine League of Women Voters has been very active in a lot of campaigns, a lot of activities to, I think lately, trying to turn down the voter ID law proposal, clean elections, where it was involved in ranked choice voting, clean elections, and also the attempt to get rid of same-day voters registration. They have very strong partners in that coalition to turn that around. And the Scholar Strategy Network, which is a national group, works to improve public policy and strengthen democracy by connecting scholars and their research to policymakers, citizen associations, and the media. And we have a slot in the Bangor Daily News every other week, which rotates members, and just have Cass do an op-ed this week. So in any case, I'm pleased to introduce our speaker and to thank the weather gods for giving us a little room here. Although we did have a problem with the atrium out there. I don't know if that's related, but we managed to get him in between all these different storms. And as advertised, he will make a presentation titled From the Margins of the Mainstream, the Transformation of the Political Right, and then take some questions, and we'll have some time for refreshments as well. Well, our speaker today is a member of the Scholar Strategy Network, this national group, is a political scientist at the University of Georgia, whose work focuses on issues of extremism, democracy, and populism. His goal is to convince people on the basis of existing research that Americans, when approached with radical political threats, need not reinvent the wheel, but can learn from other democracies how to deal with it. And he's someone who is very strong as a Republican intellectual, deeply committed to connecting with audiences outside of academia. So that commitment and the events of our day, our times, make his talk especially welcome tonight. So please join me in welcoming Catherine.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Amy, for the introduction. Thank you for inviting me. In case you heard me on the radio, where I was asked all kind of questions about the U.S. and Trump, that's not what I'm going to talk about. But you can ask me questions about that.
I'm not sure your mic is working.
This is the mic for there, but I can speak up.
We have a microphone there, though.
Okay, so I'll try it like this. So what I'm going to do is speak about the European case. And I give a very short introduction of kind of where the radical right comes from. And I will focus specifically on the wave, the so-called third wave, which is the one that we're in and that most of the attention has been given to. But I think one of the key reasons that I'm going back a little bit longer is that the Anglo-Saxon media has only discovered populism and the radical right pretty much last year. And now is, for example, all the time looking and finding Trumpism everywhere. And so it's like Trumpism is popular in Denmark, and Trumpism is popular in the Netherlands. And that's true, but the thing is that it was already popular there well before Trump became an issue. And so this will be about Europe. I'm very happy to also talk about Trump later. I have to go back and forth for my slides. So I'm going to just wait. I'm going to give you the whole slide otherwise.
Can you turn some of the lights off too?
Yeah, could we lower the
light? Okay, so even stronger, oh, that's very dark. even stronger than in the US, in much of Europe, the post-war consensus was very much about never forget, never again. Pretty much the moral compass was set around fascism. Anything that reeked of fascism was bad and was politically impossible. Now, obviously, this was shared between the Communist Party and the Democratic Party, but in the Democratic Party, they actually could run for elections. But really, we saw only a very small, weak wave of post-fascism directly after the war. There were a couple of post-fascist parties, not surprisingly, in Italy and Germany, right? Obviously, the two countries that had the strongest fascist regimes. And those parties were also really those type of groups. These were people who had been generally lower level or medium level functionaries of the local fascist party, the Italian or the German, who were not punished in Nuremberg or those kind of things, and who by and large created parties in the tradition of classic fascism. In Germany, that party was banned. In Italy, oddly enough, although it defined itself as an anti-fascist republic and had a law that stated that any post-fascist or neo-fascist party should be banned, it actually had the MSI, the Italian Social Movement, in the parliament from 1948 on, which literally said that they were the successor to the fascist party. There you see a little bit the difference in how laws are being implemented and followed in Germany versus Italy. Now, the second wave of post-war far right was a very odd wave, mostly right-wing populism. It started with this man, Pierre Pujat, in the late 50s in France. Then later, there were some smaller kind of anti-tax, anti-elite, anti-welfare state type parties in Denmark, Norway. But neither of these two waves were really across many European countries. There were also, most of the time, only 4 or 5%. So, again, I work the slides through so that I don't stand in your way. Pretty much the third wave started in the early 1980s. Actually, one of the first parties out of that wave is that man there, Hans Janmaat, of a bit oddly called Center Party, which is in my own homeland of the Netherlands. Another party was Flemish Bloc in Belgium, and then the one that you probably have heard of is the Front National, or National Front, which this poster is from, which also kind of emerged, was already founded in 1972, but it had its first successes in the 1980s. It was linked primarily to mass immigration and growing resentment. And it was the most successful post-war wave so far. But there is something to be argued that the 21st century might actually have seen a fourth wave. And the fourth wave is actually broader. There are now even more radical right party in more countries. They're also much more successful, and they have transformed a bit. And so what I will do is I will lay out pretty much what I'm talking about first. I focus primarily on parties, because European politics is party politics. And we tend to speak about a radical right party family. And a party family means a cross-national group of political parties with a shared core ideology. And so that sounds all fairly abstract, but just think about social democratic parties or Christian democratic parties or liberal parties, right? We kind of assume that a social democratic party in Germany holds roughly the same ideas as one in France. Now, the core of this particular radical right family is a combination of nativism, authoritarianism, and populism. And importantly, it is that combination of these three features that makes it populist radical right. It's not just one feature. Authoritarianism, for example, is also part of conservatism. Right? And only having authoritarianism doesn't make you populist radical right. It's the combination. So nativism is simply stated a combination of nationalism and xenophobia. It holds that the state should be inhabited only by the natives, the own people, and so should be monocultural. And it fears anything alien, non-native. Not just people, but also ideas. Like one of the things that you see in nativism in Europe, for example, is a fear of Americanization. Like McDonald's, Coca-Cola, or just the creeping prominence of the English language. Right? So it's not only immigrants or refugees. this is really at the core of all of these movements. And a lot of the other features are actually perceived through nativism. And you see that very strongly in the next part was authoritarianism. Now, authoritarianism I use in a social psychological interpretation. So it's not a non-democratic regime. It is rather the belief in order and the idea that the state should enforce order strictly through law and order policies, but also through instilling discipline in people, in schools, etc. And one of the things that you see in these posters that you can't read probably is the combination of nativism and authoritarianism. So this is the leader of the radical right in my country, the Netherlands. It says more security, less immigration. Right? And so it's very clear. This one, which is, I think, one of the best political posters ever made, because you don't perhaps read German, but you know exactly what this poster says, right? And so what it says is create security. Right? And how do you create security? By kicking out the immigrant. Right? Sure, it's racist, but it gets the message through. And again, what it does is it clearly ties like the security aspect, the authoritarianism, to nativism. And you see that very strong in the rhetoric of these parties. They speak mostly about immigrant crime and kind of create the image as if you would take care of the immigrants, if they would go, there wouldn't really be crime. And finally, populism, a much abused term, but it actually does have meaning. And so in populism, you see society as being fundamentally divided between two homogeneous and antagonistic groups, the pure people on the one hand and the corrupt elite on the other. And you want politics to follow the general will of the people. So it is an ideology. It's not just a style or a discourse. If it were to be just a style or a discourse, it wouldn't really have relevance for policies. But actually, you do see that when they come to power, that populism leads to the style of their politics and also to some changes in policies. It is monist and it is moralistic. By monist, I mean that it is the people, singular. They all have the same interest. They all have the same values. Similarly, it is the elite. It's not the elites. Like, there's only one. And all of them are corrupt. Democrat and Republican doesn't matter. Right? They say different things, but they are in essence corrupt. And so what this does, the combination, that the distinction is moral. It's not about whether you're, these people are rich and these are poor. Right? It's not a class distinction, as in Marxism. It's a moral distinction. That means that someone like Donald Trump, right, who clearly is incredibly wealthy and in no way similar to the common man, right, can be part of it because he is pure. Right? It's a stretch. Right? You have to sell it, but clearly he can. Now, the consequence of these are actually the main problem of populism. First of all, when your distinction is moral, compromise is really impossible. When the pure compromise with the corrupt, the pure get corrupted. Right? And so, whereas regular politics, where it is about interest, and you want to have a raise of 5%, and I want to give only 2%, we can meet halfway. Here you can't, because you get corrupted. On top of that, you don't deal with corrupt people. They don't have legitimacy. Because you're monist, anyone who has a different opinion is also illegitimate. They're not really part of the people. And that leads to very polarized politics. Now, obviously, the populist leader is the voice of the people. Or in French, la voix du peuple, literally on the poster. And a lot is on the corrupt elite. These are the free monkeys. These are also the three major political parties in Flanders. Mm-hmm. Right? And what the poster says is, although they are different parties, they're all the same. Mm-hmm. Right? Again, they're part of that same corrupt elite that looks away. Now, what they say that they want to do is have a real democracy. A real democracy is a democracy that listens to these pure people. And you don't have to achieve that by abolishing democracy. You have to achieve that by getting the voice of the people in power, because she or he will know what to do. So who am I talking about? This is a list of the major populist radical right parties, the broader far right parties. Some of you might know the Austrian Freedom Party. Some are much less known, like Dawn National Coalition in the Czech Republic. If you have the National Front, Alternative for Germany, that is one of the most written about parties, but also one of the smallest. But it is Germany, so we always get a little bit scared about the Germans. Now, most of these are populist radical right. There are a few exceptions. Most importantly, Greece has a party called Golden Dawn. That's actually a neo-Nazi party. The important distinction between the two is that a radical right party accepts democracy in its minimal form, namely popular sovereignty and majority rule. By and large, it agrees that the people should elect their leaders. It has problems, though, with liberal democracy, which adds to that popular sovereignty and majority rule, rule of law, protection of minority rights, pluralism. Mm-hmm. Extreme right parties like Golden Dawn don't believe in democracy. They don't think that the people should elect their leader. Like Hitler famously said that democracy was mediocrity. Right? It created, like, the leader chosen by the mediocre people. Whereas if you had someone who was superior, it made no sense to get someone else. Obviously, he was superior. And so they are the exception, but still quite remarkable. I mean, we have about 3 decades of research on the radical right. We thought that we had at least one thing that we could all agree on, and that was that a neo-Nazi party could never get elected into a national parliament. Golden Dawn has been elected and re-elected now 4 times. In a state, a country, Greece, which had seen the brunt of like very evil occupation. And so where you can have it there, it says a lot. At the moment in Slovakia, we have a neo-Nazi party in parliament as well. And the German neo-Nazi party is in the European parliament. So this is in purple, I guess, are all the parties that had reached their peak in the last election. Right? And so to give you an example of like the general story, there's a rise of the radical right. And that is kind of true, but not as clear as you might think. However, if we take into account the recent polls, you see that actually more parties are peaking. That said, this is a subset of all European countries. It's even a subset of all EU member states. I think there are about 20, roughly, countries on this in this table. There are roughly 50 countries in Europe. These are the most successful. Right? Similarly, radical right parties have very seldomly been part of government. In the 1990s, we only had a handful of governments in which the radical right was part of mostly a coalition. Like, again, you have to think, first of all, there are about 10 times as many countries. On top of that, in that period, you have roughly 3 governments. This is 2% at best of all the governments. And they're almost all in Eastern Europe, which was the first period of democracy in which nationalism was pretty broadly spread. A country like Estonia, for example, was still fighting with the Russian-speaking minority. Many of these parties are now either irrelevant or have moderated. You do see a rise, though, of government participation. So this is in the 2000s, and the trend clearly is up. The other thing is there's a switch much more to Western Europe. Although there's still some East European countries, there are now more often radical right parties in government. At this point in time, though, up until pretty much 2010, radical right parties were almost always in a coalition government, and then they were the junior partner, which meant that they were the small party, often pretty much dominated by the more center-right party, which would have the prime minister. So as an overview, radical right parties have gained more and more support, but if you actually calculate it, and this is Western Europe, it's obviously in the 1980s, elections in the Communist Party didn't really work well, it was 1.7% of the vote, 4.8% in the 1990s, 5.9% in the 2000s, the first decade. If you would calculate it today, we'd estimate it to be around 10%. Now, 10% might be shocking, but if you have 90% of the vote, you're doing pretty well. Mm-hmm. Right? And so it's important to remember that a majority is 50% plus. Right? 90% is a massive majority. So 90% voting for pretty much liberal democratic parties, you would think, what's all the fuss about? It's mostly about that this is very unevenly spread. Right? We have countries where the radical right gets almost 40%, and we have a lot where they get zero. And so, for example, last year there were elections in 12 countries in Europe. The average score of the radical right was 4.2%. which is kind of insane in the year of the radical right, where the only thing that we talked about was Brexit and Trump. Now, the main reason is that there were elections in countries which doesn't have a strong radical right. This year, there are elections in the Netherlands, France, and Germany, and that average is going to go up significantly. So they participate more often in national government, but it's still an exception. And their political influence has so far been mostly indirect, because they're hardly ever in government. Their effect is in agenda setting. They set the political agenda. Right? They determine what other parties talk about. And as a consequence of that, they often also start to set the frame. So it's not just that we talk about immigrants, but we talk about immigrants as a security threat, mm-hmm. rather than as an economic issue, for example. Mm-hmm. Right? And so in that sense, you do have influence. And then the refugee crisis. Now, the refugee crisis clearly scared a lot of people in this country. But we're talking about 20,000 that might come in. In 2015 alone, roughly 1.5 million refugees came into Europe. About 850,000 went to Germany alone. Right? This was unprecedented. Even the early 1990s, when the Bosnian Civil War led to massive immigration and refugees, it was nothing like this. And it has profoundly affected European parties and politics. Most importantly is that this man, Viktor Orban, who's the Hungarian Prime Minister, has become the most powerful voice of the European radical right. And that stands directly for a transformation of some right-wing parties. Viktor Orban, until 2015, was broadly considered a conservative. Various conservative parties throughout Europe have moved significantly to the right. I would argue Viktor Orban has become radical right, probably the party in Poland, Law and Justice as well. But some other people, like my Prime Minister, Mark Rutte, has increasingly adopted radical right ideological positions. And this is different because before, right-wing parties would adopt the discourse, right? And so they would take the issues, they would take the frame, but they wouldn't take the policies. And so although various mainstream politicians, German Chancellor Angela Merkel or former British Prime Minister David Cameron, or former French Prime Minister Nicolas Sarkozy, they've all said that multiculturalism has failed. This is a bold statement. And you would think, well, then you probably have changed your policies. But they haven't. Like, so the discourse was there, it has failed, it's bad, it's problematic, right? But the policies haven't changed. And even when policies changed a bit, mostly a strengthening of immigration, which is already very limited anyway, as well as setting certain demands on integration, most of the time the argument was, we need to do this to save our multicultural democracy. Like, so the original goal was still the same, but the argument was it's not working. Right? So we have to be a bit tougher on the immigrants because they're not integrating well enough. In 2015, refugees became a problem. They became a security threat. Right? Politicians, I don't have to work hard to come up with examples in this country of politicians linking refugees and terrorism. But throughout Europe, like right-wing politicians, not radical right ones, but mainstream right ones, have linked refugees to terrorism. Right? And so we now have also mainstream parties that are actually sharing the basic idea. And the basic idea is that immigration is a problem which we have to manage. It's no longer an enrichment, it's a problem. And the only real debate is, how many do we let in? Before, there was a position of, you think it's bad, I think it's good. Right? Almost no one says that multiculturalism is good anymore. And of course, we have a new world. Brexit, which was last year, where Brits decided in a referendum that they were going to leave the European Union, has pushed the EU into an even deeper crisis. Now, the European Union was already struggling for pretty much a decade, partly because of the Great Recession, partly for other reasons. But this is the first time that a country goes out. This is the first time that the EU, which is a decade-long process, is taking a step back. This has phenomenal symbolic power. First of all, the mere option of getting out is now realistic. Until Brexit, everyone said that that was just stupid. Any party who would put that forward was no longer realistic, like a party. And the argument would be that, well, I mean, you would be destroyed or the economy would be over. Now, Brexit is not working out too well for the Brits at the moment, but the country is also not going bankrupt. Right? There's not war. And so the debate about what to do with Europe is now not anymore we're going forward or we stay at the same place. It's also we're going back, which is, of course, what the radical right has always wanted. Massive difference in the two powers. Right? Putin is relatively open. Well, Putin is open to anyone who challenges the status quo, the Western-dominated status quo, including the EU, which means that through mostly his surrogates, as well as his party, United Russia, he will lend some kind of support to radical right parties. He also supports radical left parties or mainstream parties, pretty much anyone who will want to break the sanctions. But for the radical right, this is new because they've always been shunned by any political leader. And so to be able to say, well, the Russians want me, that's good. It's even better if you could say the president of the United States likes me. At least for the moment, you can sell that. And so there's only one European politician, as far as I know, who has personally met Donald Trump. Do we know who that is? Theresa May. Second one. And actually, the other one was also British, Nigel Farage, who is of the UK Independence Party, one of the key persons to like push for Brexit. He's now also a Fox commentator. But he has been on the phone with Viktor Orban and directly invited him over to the White House well before Angela Merkel. So although Trump himself is not really meeting with most of the radical right leaders, a lot of people around him, of course, particularly Steve Bannon, right, has very clear preferences for these politicians. And so what they can now in the campaign say whenever they're being accused of, well, if you elect them, we're going to be isolated, is not at all. If you elect me, we will actually be invited to the White House, right? And we can go to the Kremlin. And so that is a completely different scope, even though this is not a populist international. Like, actually, I have not seen one picture yet of Putin with a radical right politician. But it shows, and they can use it as times are changing. And we are much more a reflection of these new times than those old politicians. On top of that, in the coming years, we're going to see more radical right parties entering national governments. This man, Hatze Strache, is the leader of the Austrian Freedom Party. The Austrian Freedom Party is currently number one in the polls, 35% of the vote, for over a year by now. Second biggest party is around 20%. It's inevitable. It's inevitable that he is going to be the new prime minister, and actually both the center-left and the center-right are already vying for his attention for several months. The Danish People's Party is also very close to getting to power. And as said, some of the traditional parties have now become radical right parties. And so we have a radical right party in power in Hungary, we have one in power in Poland. And as a consequence, they're gaining influence within the EU, because the real power in the EU is still in the European Council. And the European Council is where the leaders of the individual nation states are, so the prime ministers. And that's where Orban is now. And that's where Strache might be. So, concluding, radical right has transformed from a marginal force in Europe into a mainstream in part of Europe. And that's important, because in at least one third of Europe, there is no populist radical right party at all. And then roughly another third, they are a relevant opposition player. But nevertheless, in about a third, they are among the top three parties, if not the first one. They increasingly define the terms of the political and public debate. We talk since 2015 only about terrorism, immigration, and political incompetence. Those are the only things that we have. Those are their issues. They profit. And they face a much more accommodating national and global context than ever. Also nationally, there are more and more right-wing parties, and even sometimes center-left parties, that are open to collaboration. And so where before they would be ostracized and marginal, right, now they're becoming kingmakers, and sometimes they actually have the choice. But I think there are some signs of a liberal democratic backlash. We see in the last 2 months a drop in the polls of Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, the AfD in Germany, and a strict stabilization of Marine Le Pen, even though her main right-wing competitor has completely imploded because of a scandal. The other thing is, and I truly believe that, although this might be just wishful thinking, I think there will actually be a Trump effect, but it is not the one that everyone is writing about at the moment. Dutch people don't vote for Geert Wilders because Americans have voted for Trump. It doesn't work like that. The only reason why they might do that is because of Trump, the Dutch media writes about the themes of Trump, which are also the themes of Wilders. But radical right parties initially had a very careful approach to Trump. They didn't say that he was one of them, but they said that the Trump phenomenon was very similar to what they stood for. Right? And so they defined it in their terms. This is the good people, the real people, the heartland, like standing up to the corrupt cosmopolitan elites, right? And they're now taking it back, and we're going to do that in the Netherlands, France, Germany, whatever it is. But since he got elected president, many of the radical right parties started to also really praise Trump. The problem is, and the risk is, Trump is phenomenally unpopular in Europe. I mean, around the world, but particularly in Europe. And he is even very unpopular among the electorates of radical right parties. Like, so even Front National, roughly two-thirds of Front National voters, like, don't like Trump. if Trump continues what he is doing now, which is pretty much creating chaos, that will have an effect. And even though radical right politicians in Europe are much better politicians than Trump, and they're actually politicians, right? Marine Le Pen has worked as a lawyer for a couple of years, but was born into a political family. Geert Wilders is, I think, the fourth longest serving parliamentarian in the Netherlands. Right? Has 2 years at a different job. These are politicians, just as other politicians. That's their game. That's what they do. Right? And so Trump is a completely different phenomenon. But still, if they get too close to him, and Trump messes up, and Brexit messes up, people who are not true supporters but kind of feel that they want to protest through the radical right, which is a significant part of their electorate, will not take that risk. And so I think that, unfortunately, the Dutch will not be saved by this because we have elections next month and it's too early. But September, you have elections in Germany. I mean, of course, by that time, Trump might be the best president there ever was. But in the unlikely event that that's not the case, then particularly the Germans, because in Germany things need to be stable and calm, right, will definitely step back from this. And so I think that in the coming months we're going to see increasingly a Trump effect where radical right parties are going to try and distance themselves increasingly from him while still trying to keep the momentum of the Trump phenomenon. And on the other hand, we're going to see a debate in which we are no longer talking about how good it is to have an outsider to shake things up, but how dangerous it is to have an outsider who doesn't play by the rules. Thank you.
Yes. You talked about the rise largely, I think, in terms of immigration. And you mentioned that it also had a little pulse with the recession, you know, in 2008 or whatever. What else is behind it? We think of it mostly as xenophobic, you know, from our point of view. What other factors are there?
Okay, so the Great Recession didn't actually lead to an increase of radical right support. There were some that won, and there were some that lost. Now, of course, the Great Recession didn't hit countries in the same way. Like we talk about the European crisis, but Greece is really in crisis. Germany isn't. Mm-hmm. And so you have to take that into account. The radical right profits from definitely like anything related to nativism, which is immigrants, but also European Union. Right? And what the Great Recession did was bring to the fore what the European Union actually was. And so one of the things about the European Union is it's always been wildly popular because no one actually knew what it was. And it was still the project to never have war again. Right? Yeah. And so for many generations, that was a defining thing. Mm. There are now like at least half of the population, which doesn't have a direct or even indirect link to that, to the Second World War. And so the idea that you would give up certain things so that you don't have war isn't that strong anymore. On top of that, European Union is now affecting our lives in many more ways than it ever did. One of the things is the Eurozone, which actually no one really understood. Like the Euro, the common currency, was sold as pretty much now you don't have to exchange money when you go abroad, which is awesome. Right? I mean, I lived in the Netherlands, I would be abroad every second weekend, pretty much. This is 2 hours, right? And so that I didn't have to have all my money all the time with me, it was great. Then the Great Recession started and turned out that we had to bail out Greece because our economies are now completely linked. Yeah, no one told us that, right? And so a lot of people are like, wait, yeah. I also have to do that. Mm-hmm. that is a major issue because most parties, at least until a couple of years ago, were pro-European, and so it was easy to take that on. There's a lot of dissatisfaction about crime, as well as just the lack of discipline, which is often related to immigrants, but not only. Like, I mean, among older people about how the youth like whatever jaywalk or hold their feet up in the bus and those kind of things, to just I mean, pestering youth in towns, as well as just the misperception that crime is on the rise. Every single country seems to have that. There's a lot of people who always think that crime is on the rise, even though often totally isn't the case. And then there is a real growing resentment towards elites in general, which have various reasons. And actually, I think the most important one is a positive one, which is what American political scientist Ronald Engelhardt has called cognitive mobilization. And cognitive mobilization just by and large means that people are better educated now and are more independent. And so they actually now hold elites accountable. Because in the golden age of the 1950s, if you're on the right, or the 1970s, if you're on the left, most people didn't really vote. Well, they voted, they didn't choose. Mm-hmm. Right? And so they just did what they had always done, what their parents did, or what their subculture did. Politicians didn't explain things better then. Most of them didn't explain anything. But most people didn't need an explanation. They were totally fine by voting for someone who was better at it than them. Now we're all better than the president. We all know better, right? And so the task for politicians has become more difficult. On top of that, politics has become much more multidimensional. Like, we have a socioeconomic dimension. We have a socio-cultural one about, let's say, crime or, in this country, abortion. And now we also have a national cosmopolitan type one, right? It's impossible almost to find a party that is exactly where you are on all of those points, right? And so that creates a much looser tie to individual parties and more resentment. And I think those things all come together, including politicians who no longer lead. I think that's also very important. Like, politicians have totally swallowed the Kool-Aid that populism it can't beat populism. Like, you can't lead people, you have to follow people. And so increasingly mainstream politicians who are not populist are pretty much talking as if the people are right, and as if they have to follow them. If you do that, then you set yourself up for failure, right? Because let's face it, we are never wrong, right? So if we think that we should do Brexit and we vote Brexit and it doesn't go well, it wasn't because we made the wrong choice, it was because you elite didn't implement it right. And so I think all of those things come together, right? And if you look at today, there's just an ideological vacuum, not so much here in the US, but definitely in Europe. Center-left has pretty much given up on social democracy in the 1990s. When Clinton did it here, Blair did it in Britain, and the others followed. The center-right has given up on Christian democracy. Most of the liberal parties have given up on that, and liberal in European context means more libertarian. They've become much more conservative too. And so at the moment, you only hear one voice, one coherent voice. That's the radical right. Against that, you get kind of pragmatic things of, well, it isn't that bad, right? Well, we shouldn't do that. Yes, you're right, there's a problem, but we shouldn't do that, right? That's not particularly inspiring, particularly not when you're facing a crisis. On top of that, we have many generations now, at least two, who are going to be worse off than previous generations, right?
Yes.
They make a sacrifice, at least they feel that they do. At the very least, they want to know why. Right? And that story is not given. Yes.
What do you think would be an effective left of center mobilization
that could win against this resurgent right.
Yeah, I got that off. Now, the sad thing is I got this already since the 1980s. And so either I'm wrong, or they don't do what I say. Probably both. So I think, from a left-wing perspective, there's no electoral strategy at the moment. Because, and I'm going to say we, because I am on the left, we have lost ideological hegemony already in the 80s with neoliberalism. And we have lost it roughly with regard to social cultural issues increasingly since 9/11. And so at the moment, most people, while they overall support actually still relatively center-left ideas about refugees, about immigrants, well, not going so well with the immigrants, they by and large don't buy into solidarity. They don't buy into the core terms and ideas of the left. And so until they do that, left-wing parties don't stand a chance at having big successes. And this is what, I mean, this is what requires, they call it Gramscian approach. And I mean, he was an Italian communist who by and large argued that political victory can only follow cultural victory. And so that's what I believe where the left is at the moment. Because the left has its own bubbles, right? The left still has the best think tanks in Europe, right? And so they're all the time talking to each other about how they should solve things. And I think like, wow, where were so many? Everyone thinks like me. They have to go back into the street. Right? Not write like very intellectual stuff and talk to each other about it in like the salons of the capitals. No, they actually have to do groundwork. They have to go back into areas, not to white working class areas. Right? Social democracy is an ideology, is a movement. It's not the interest group of white working class. Right? And so part of the white working class is lost.
Yeah.
I mean, partly because they're racist. You just have to accept that, right? And so unless you become racist, they're not coming back. Another part might come back, but far more importantly, sizable portions of the working class in Europe today is non-white. Right? And so this idea that the working class is white, right, is a misrepresentation increasingly. I think that we should have much more initiatives that are actually very practical, very local, where people do things together across line. One of the most depressing things about the 2016 elections to me was not that social democratic parties or the Democrats were wrong in their polls, although it's amazing. Like I met Stan Greenberg, who is the major poller of the Democratic Party. It's frightening when you hear how much data they have on us. It's even more frightening to know how much wrong he was. I mean, I met him in July, and he was absolutely certain that it was going to be a blowout. But fine, that's a bubble. I also spoke at a meeting of AFL-CIO in May, and I was shocked that they were totally wrong. Because actually the trade unions do still have contacts to mostly white working class, depends on what trade union you are, of course. They said that they would probably 20% of their members would vote for Trump. Mm-hmm. Now we don't have the final numbers, but it's probably closer to 40. Right? That just shows that clearly no one has a clue. Right? Mm-hmm. When the major party doesn't know, and when the trade union doesn't know, you have to start thinking about different initiatives. Mm-hmm. And I think that those are local, and those are pretty much more low politics, right? Not with meetings where we all read Marx and talk about how relevant he still is, but where we actually, as a community, come together to take care of whatever it is, certain projects of abandoned houses, or of filth that is everywhere, and we clean it up, whatever that is. But that, and that, combine that with a discourse of solidarity. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is religion playing a role in all of this? If yes, at what extent?
It didn't until 9/11. Right? 9/11 didn't so much create new enemies for the radical right, it redefined them. And so before 9/11, the enemies in the Netherlands were the Turks, the Moroccans, and the Surinamese. Surinamese are former slaves from a small colony in Latin America. After 9/11, our enemies are the Muslims. Surinamese are no longer the enemy, so that's kind of the one positive part of the Islamophobia. Non-white people who are non-Muslim have gone up significantly in the ranking. But Turks and Moroccans are no longer Turks and Moroccans. They're Muslims. And so obviously when your enemy is defined social, religiously, because it is both in terms of religious aspects and more cultural aspects, you have to kind of start to think about what that says about you. Right? Now, here it's pretty clear in the US, of course. Right? You're Christian. In the Netherlands, it's very hard. Right? A minority of Dutch people are Christian, and an even smaller group of that wants to self-identify as Christian. Any party that says we're a party of Christians who fight off the Muslims is going to be maximum 10%. Right? But you do see a bigger emphasis on Judeo-Christian values, sometimes secular Judeo-Christian values, even though all three have killed each other for centuries. But that is the consequence of the predominance of Islamophobia. But overall, religion is actually still a hindrance to radical rancor, because most people who are religious in the sense that they actually go to church, which is a tiny group in most European countries, they will vote for the religious party. Even if they hold exactly the values of the radical right, they will still do what the priest or the pastor says. And so religion and radical right is much less connected. I would, here with Trump, like one of the most amazing things, of course, was that he scored, I think, the highest of virtually every group among evangelicals. So it was 92%, which, I mean, that's remarkable, put it mildly. I wonder what, like, whether that truly only was the Supreme Court justices. This is what people like Ralph Reed said. In the end, it doesn't matter what he does. We have Supreme Court justices, and we need to have people against abortion. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure whether really it was only that. For some reason, they also just seem to be attracted to Trump. But again, religion is not direct only linked to him. Right? I mean, other religious people went very strongly for Cruz.
Yeah. In the States, we've become used to talking about the difference between rural and urban takes on immigration. Are there similar patterns in Europe, or is it more mixed than that?
So there are very, very strong urban-rural patterns in Eastern Europe, particularly in Poland and Hungary, and actually Austria shows it at the moment as well. It's not always clear what that is, not only immigration, because immigration was not an issue until the refugee crisis, for example. But there are some other aspects here. Various West European countries have that less. The Netherlands has virtually no rural areas. I mean, everything is 2 hours away from each other. And it's just one big suburb. pretty much. In Belgium, the same. What we do see, though, is that the radical right tends not to do very well in many cities, particularly not so much in capitals. The reason is pretty simple. It's mostly higher educated people that work there. It's more expensive to be there. Provincial cities, they tend to do better, as well as kind of towns outside of a big city. So those are still homogeneous, relatively homogeneous towns, but they have regular interaction with multicultural cities. And so their ideas, we have to act now, otherwise we will become like them. Whereas many of the racist people in particular who live in big cities, they know it's not going to happen anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, it's been for decades, they're here. And so they don't vote quite often.
So it does suggest a problem for working locally if people with left ideals are in the urban centers and the need to educate and talk is with the people in the rural areas where we go to rural areas and we're not farm workers, we don't come from farm families perhaps. How do we bridge those sorts of gaps?
Well, I think first of all, when I talk about, this is not about so much about changing the minds of the core radical right supporter. Mm-hmm. It's not going to change.
Not gonna happen.
This is about, first of all, that part that attaches to it mostly because of resentment, but also increasingly for all others, including people who vote for center-left parties who by and large also don't really believe in social democracy and solidarity anymore. But I actually take the point, and I think it's one of the things that I've been arguing for a long time, is that the US has this also very, very strong. I mean, almost every intellectual activity is in DC or New York.
Yeah.
Right? And there everyone talks with people who never lived anywhere else than there about like how the rest of the country has to change. That's problematic. And that's not to say that there isn't racism in New York. I mean, my wife's from New York. She's not racist, but her whole neighborhood, by and large, pretty much was. Trump's a very good example of that type of racism. And so I think there's more than enough work to be done in the urban centers. But no, it's true. But on the other hand, there's also a lot of progressive people in those communities. Often they just have no support. And so there's a group I work with in Britain, it's called Hope Not Hate. It's an anti-racist group. But what I find particularly important about them is, first of all, it's hope, not hate. The emphasis is on hope. It's not so much as most anti-racist or anti-fascist group that are exclusively focused on destroying the fascist. Mm-hmm. Right? This is about creating, strengthening tolerant society. This is pretty much what they do. They go into areas where the radical right is strong, and they're talking to people. They find local people who are anti-racist, right? And they just reach out. They make a larger group. Right? This is not a similar movement as the civil rights movement of the 60s, right? Where like white kids from the big cities drive down to the south and that's not it. That's not going to work. But it's about resources for people outside of these cities. And in that, unfortunately, there are very few resources. Right? Almost every organization that is created. And like, I'm trying to set up a center for the analysis of democracy and extremism at the moment at the University of Georgia. Right? And one of the things I already got is like, so where are you going to do it? I said, well, I'm in Georgia. So wouldn't you be interested in doing it in DC? Right? That's the direct thing, because that's where the people with the money are, and if they're going to give money, they want to go to the events, and they don't want to go all the way to Georgia. Right? And so that is something that people have to overcome. And I think that's why trade unions are still very important.
Yeah.
because trade unions do actually still have those connections.
Do you care to say anything about how the United States went from, you know, from the margin to the mainstream in a year or less or something?
Yeah, I think partly, so on the one hand, over a very long period of time, on the other hand, by freak accident. To me, Trump is, I hope, the last stand of the Southern strategy that the Republicans started, of course, decades back. This was the logical consequence. And you could see that. After Mitt Romney, they tried to, for a very short period of time, become inclusive. You can't do that if you have been arguing pretty much white privilege for decades, right? And so he by and large took that to the extreme. Now, that would have failed under virtually every other circumstance, but there was no other front runner, 17 weak candidates, a unique radical right candidate. Trump probably had the biggest name recognition of all the candidates when he started. And now imagine, yeah, like that is almost impossible. And a very divided field, and so the media needs someone that people want to watch. That all came perfectly together. On top of that, well, I don't think he captured the Republican Party, and you see that many of his views are shared by the majority of Republican voters. He is still very different from radical right parties in Europe, because he actually went through the mainstream. Without the Republican primary, he also wouldn't have won. As a third party candidate, he wouldn't have stood a chance. Probably would have had less success than Ross Perot. So everything came together for that. And on top of that, everything that was bad about him looked good compared to Clinton. So Clinton was also the perfect candidate for him. First of all, it was a woman that helped. Right. Was the ultimate insider, uncharismatic in all kinds of ways. And so it had no, for all kinds of reasons, had stood no chance in debates with him. He was brutal, like, and loud and obnoxious, but he was a man. If Clinton would have responded by shouting, she was hysterical. If she would have, or emotional, or like bitchy, I mean, whatever it is, like there was nothing for her to win. If it would have been a Republican who was just talking about policies, right, she would have been great. But against this person, right, she was just so. I honestly think, I mean, of course, we always have to remember that he didn't win the popular vote. The margins in the states that changed were very, very small. The campaign of Clinton was disastrous, absolutely disastrous. I mean, completely not understanding the Trump effect in the Rust Belt state, but also, I think, as a consequence of the primaries, where she did so well among minorities compared to Sanders, she by and large kind of thought that they would come out to vote. The fact of the matter was that Sanders was virtually as wide a campaign as Trump. And so this was actually not so much about African Americans liking Hillary Clinton, just African Americans not being interested in Bernie Sanders. And so I think she made many tactical mistakes. As long as Americans will vote according to the same rules with the same electorate, I'm absolutely certain that Trump will be a one-term president. I'm not so confident that the same electorate is going to vote. I mean, the attorney general that has just been appointed has a very, very long track record in voter disenfranchisement. And I think that this is not Trump. Republicans have been doing this for the last couple of years. They understand, they know that they can't win this again with the same electorate, which will be even more diverse in 4 years, right? And so I think that those things mean there's very little solace in it, but it's important still to remember that this was just a freak accident.
I wonder if you looked at anything about the role of demographic, like generational differences age-wise. I mean, it certainly seems that, at least in college areas and urban areas, it seems that there's much more kind of tolerance amongst younger, amongst people like basically millennials and younger people, for example. So, I mean, have you seen anything suggesting that there's anything meaningful age-wise?
Okay, so the electorate of radical right parties in Europe overall tends to be more masculine, roughly 60%. Many of the successful parties are disproportionately young, but the young vote for the radical right or for kind of green parties or libertarian parties. So they vote both for the most nationalist and the most multicultural. On average, young people are much more tolerant towards diversity.
Yes. Okay?
But there is a sizable group, mostly lower educated, that goes particularly towards the radical right. Education plays a major role. And it's important to see it for what it is. First of all, yes, intolerance is largely learned, and if you go to school longer, you learn it longer. But also, if you have a lower education, the last couple of decades have been disastrous. Right? In Germany, one of my colleagues once complained that he was a professor, and he made something like 10% more than a factory worker at Mercedes.
Hmm.
Right? If you think about the old factory jobs at Ford in Michigan, right, and what they did for you in terms of security, in terms of like what they brought to your family and possibilities to study, right, all those jobs are almost gone. And in Europe, they're increasingly gone too. And so they actually have different interests, right? What Clinton sold, for example, here, was not interesting for them. And I think that is one of the things that you see, actually, in many radical right parties in Europe, have a relatively center-left socioeconomic program. Very anti-globalization, want to protect the vulnerable, but of course only our own, the natives. Right? That's what we call welfare chauvinism. They support the welfare state strongly, but only for the own people. Right? And that is attractive too. Right? Because again, these young people, right, they hear about the welfare state. That's what their grandparents had and that's what their parents had, but they don't have it. And I think that's something where the left has horribly failed in the last couple of decades.
Yeah. You had mentioned that extreme right leaders throughout Europe don't like Trump. So I was hoping maybe you could elaborate on how they interact with each other. Do they enjoy good relations between each other, or do they generally all dislike each other as well?
So traditionally, they have mostly disliked each other, but one of the reasons why the radical right barely works together is because up until 10 years ago, they were so small that they didn't even have the resources for it. Currently, they work together because of the European Parliament. Right? So the EU has its own parliament. If you can work together there, you can get access to a lot of money. And so they have an incentive to work together. A couple of weeks ago, there was a meeting in Koblenz in Germany where leaders of 6-7 different radical right parties came together. They actually like each other. There are very good vibes there. Interesting side note, the undisputed leader of the radical right in Europe is a woman, Marine Le Pen, which is quite interesting to see. Like, there's a picture of all the leaders where she stands in front of them, and they stand behind her, right? And it's absolutely undisputed. The relationships are pretty good. The problem is, this is only a subset of the parties. So these parties don't work together with the extreme right parties. Right? And parties like the Danish People's Party don't work together with them, because the Danish People's Party is by and large accepted now in Denmark and doesn't want to get tainted by being close to Front National. And so in the end, national strategic considerations are still always trumping kind of international collaboration. But the international collaboration is better now than it's ever been, but still very poor compared to other parties.
Many of us were surprised at the response to Sanders' campaign, a strong response. Do you think there's any hope for a leftist direction from that phenomenon?
Well,
could you repeat the question?
Yeah. Sorry?
I didn't hear the question.
Okay, well, it was about the surprising response to Bernie Sanders' campaign and whether that kind of provides hope for the future. I see it a little bit different. I mean, yes, it was surprising, but it also, again, was very much defined by Hillary Clinton. It was at least as much an anti-Clinton campaign as it was a pro-Sanders campaign. But the most remarkable thing is exactly the same as with Occupy Wall Street. It just disappeared. Right? The Sanders campaign was completely irrelevant in the 2016 election. As soon as he had conceded, right, they didn't do anything. They didn't mobilize for candidates at the local level or at the state level. They didn't push anymore, and there's nothing left now. Occupy Wall Street, compare it to the Tea Party. Right? Sure, the Tea Party was always much bigger, but Occupy Wall Street is done for. It doesn't exist anymore. So dude in Oregon, who has all the rights to the studio and the name, he interviewed me once and it's like, wait, are you Occupy Wall Street Radio? I said, yeah, I just got it. The Tea Party played a major role in the Trump campaign. Right? The Tea Party is still a major player in the Midwest and parts of the South in local and state politics. And so this is the problem of the left. The left is obsessed with presidential elections. And it's all or nothing. Right? So if they win, yeah, they have that. But that's also the only thing they have. Right? Yeah. The right has everything else. Like one of the things that most people miss is the complete and utter dominance of the Republicans throughout the United States, not Congress. They're very close to a constitutional majority. Right? And I'm not even talking about school boards. Right? And all of those other parts, right? The right is just so much better at doing grassroots politics. And the left's response to that is, well, it's all astroturf. No, it's not astroturf. It's not all like Koch brothers put money in. I was for a while in Indiana at DePauw University, small liberal arts college in Greencastle, Indiana. Every first Monday of the month, there were 150 to 200 people coming together. It was the Tea Party. Every single time. It was a very small town. Right? That's momentum, and that's grassroots. Early bros don't come together. Right? And so I don't see that. I think it showed that there is something, but it also showed that there's still no understanding of how to build an organization. And I think this is the big challenge now. Right? The women march was fantastic, but you can't organize that 4 years long. No. You need to have an organization at all levels, federal, state, and even local, to keep momentum.
Yeah.
Right? And that is where often many of these groups kind of step out. They don't like that.
My wife and I have been talking about what could the Democratic Party do. And I think she has an excellent idea that echoes your local idea. Some of the Bangor legislators, one in particular I think of, really helped some people, you know, with their insurance and everything else, helped them a lot, and they're very loyal to them. If the party were to become one that helps people, that's their goal. to help others, like you're saying, these smaller groups. If someone has trouble, they go to the Democratic Party, and the party can try to pull strings to do whatever they can to make it better, or turn it over to someone who can. So that, and not be looking for political donations, not be pushing the ideology as much, but just trying to help and become known as, like the labor unions were in the, like in Philadelphia and places, where they're there to help people get whatever they need.
Yeah, I mean, in political science, we kind of have a term for that, which is clientelism. And it's difficult to do that and not abuse it. Right? And so what you see is that quite often politicians who help people out become authoritarian and corrupt. It has to be done at such a level that it isn't a personal connection. And with trade unions, for example, it wasn't so much the person but the union. But even there, right, trade unions did a lot of things for certain people and kept many other people out of very good paying jobs. Right? That's kind of the consequence of doing that. And so it's, yes, politicians should in general do more for people, but I'm always a bit worried about that. But it is something very American, right? Because you expect that of your senator and of your House of Representatives. Like, you want pork. You're all against pork, but you want yours to deliver, right? And so there's this odd kind of schism in it. And so that's, I think that this would create the same problem, right? So you would be happy with the one who provides you, and you would say that the other ones are corrupt because they do it to someone else.
So in America, we've seen a devolution of journalism to infotainment. Would you say in Europe that media coverage is pretty decent, or do they also have propaganda?
Yeah, I mean, obviously we have propaganda. News is definitely much better, depending a bit on the country. Mm-hmm. But countries like Germany, for example, have two state channels on TV, which still provide news at a set hour where a majority of Germans watch it.
Mm-hmm. It's pretty accurate.
It's very good compared to what's here on TV. Mm. But all the media has become much more sensationalist, because they've become much more economic. Like, most media were either fully state funded or they were funded by political parties. Mm-hmm. Now almost all just work as private media, and that leads to different incentives. I do believe, though, there's a lot of hype about Breitbart coming to Europe. I honestly think that they won't have much effect. So Breitbart actually already exists in Britain, has very little effect. The reason is very simple. If you ever see British tabloids, you really don't need Breitbart. They're horrible. I don't think they can do much in Germany because they're very tight laws. Right? I mean, half of the content would be considered hate speech.
How does that work in Germany? I'm curious about that. How do they regulate media?
Strict, because they regulate speech very strict, right? And so U.S. has very broad freedom of speech. Germany has quite narrow. And so if Breitbart would want to be so edgy, like in Germany as they are here, they're going to be banned for sure, right? Now, Breitbart, without being insulting, is not an interesting product. Right, and so Breitbart, that's what Breitbart does, right? And so the U.S. is perfect for that because it has that free speech. So overall, the media has become less good. People read less and watch less. But already for decades, if you compare how Americans read to how West Europeans read, and so it's a world apart. Americans don't read. Like, not literature, but also not newspapers. They really stand out compared to other advanced democracies. And so, yes, you have the New York Times, which is a pretty decent newspaper. How many people read the New York Times? Right? in the Netherlands, we still have a lot of local newspapers. They're actually pretty decent. And so I do think that the media surrounding context is better, but it's much worse than it is.
Well, I'd like to stop this question period right now. Why don't we, some people could stay around, ask some questions. We also have some refreshments here. So I'd just like to thank you very much for coming. And let's thank again our